I have an urgency like my house was on fire. This is how urgent it is right now. And I have to get out of bed in the morning, and I have to tape here. I have to share this. And who knows, maybe I'll just keep taping continuously because the time is now. We have to get this information out. This, by the way, this is a narrative here. It's not a dialogue. It's not a discussion. It's not an argument. It's a narrative. It's like A Course in Miracles is a narrative. Jesus says, this is truth. So this here is a narrative. And the skills are managing the wow of it. When hearing this and managing the wow of it, there was a huge wow this morning from the Holy Spirit sharing with me a new practice, as it were. And let's see if I can give that out to you. It's quite extraordinary. It's quite drastic. But it's perfectly in tune with the times that we are living in right now, where there's a strong indication of September is going to be a pivotal time, which will attempt to pivot us in a certain direction that we don't want to go in. And so we're going to punch first, all right? I'm aware this massive punch, a 1-2 punch, is coming in September. And instead of taking it on the chin and trying to recover, we're going to punch first here. Okay, so this is what's happening. We're punching first. No longer are we going to just keep reacting to what the world is doing. We're going to now take the lead, take the initiative, and punch first. And the Holy Spirit landed a knockout blow this morning. So, settle in. You know, we're all about managing the success of the path here, managing the wow factor. And so, full stop in the wow. Be calm, sit still. Be calm, be quiet, be still. This helps manage the wow extraordinarily. Be committed to no action when listening. No action. It seems like the stiller you are, the easier it is to manage the wow, which means the faster you can go. This is like almost like spiritual shock treatment. We have something pretty, very wonderfully shocking to say. And let me just sort of put it in a phrase like this. There is no enlightenment in enlightenment. There is no enlightenment in enlightenment. And this is a wonderful, like almost like a koan, you know, it's a wonderful, wonderful statement. It's shocking at first. What do you mean? You know, but I took it in the right way. So there's no enlightenment in enlightenment. So this can be our little, this is our assertion now in our practice here. We have three phases: assertion, full stop in the wow, assertion, wow, and flipping the script, where we kind of examine it and talk about it and examine it and change our perspective. So there is no enlightenment in enlightenment. Enlightenment doesn't have any enlightenment. There is no enlightenment in enlightenment. Now, this came from going to steady myself here. First time giving this out to the world. There is no enlightenment in enlightenment. And believe it or not, this is the key to enlightenment. Enlightenment is the recognition that there is no enlightenment in enlightenment. That is the enlightenment. And to get it more detailed, enlightenment is the recognition that there's no reaction from God to enlightenment whatsoever. And this is what the Holy Spirit showed me. And I was willing to look at this. Now, we're used to the prodigal son idea of this. And this contradicts the prodigal son parable in the Bible. It says that, you know, the prodigal son who's been away for so long comes back and God is so overjoyed, throws a massive party, and is just, you know, just weeping and just elated and all these reactions from God, the king in the parable, which symbolizing God. And what I found out this morning was that is what is blocking us, this false notion that somehow God is going to react to our realization that we never left. And that God doesn't react. That somehow God is going to react to our realization that God never reacts. This is the trouble. So when I say there's no enlightenment in enlightenment, it's the realization that God is not going to react to our realization that God does not react to our realization. So we realize that, oh, we're in the absolute stillness, non-reactivity of God. And there's absolutely no reaction to this realization. So it's like we're saying, I'm back. And there's no response, no reaction, nothing. Just the stillness just remains exactly as it's always been. Now, I was stunned by this. But something in me said, you know what? I like this. You know, at first I said, well, where's the party? I mean, I'm back. Where's it? And then I said, wait a minute. Maybe this is to our advantage here. And my ultimate reaction is a positive one. Superficially, what we might say, keep saying, well, where's the party? I mean, I did all this effort to return, to get back, you know, and I've done this, and I've been, and God doesn't throw me a party. What's going on? So we'll take our time with this. This is an extraordinary step to take, a drastic step to take, and I know it's pushing everybody here, everyone, and yet we're getting it out here, so it's being heard. There is no party when we return home. There's no reaction at all. Not the slightest recognition. Except we've recognized that we're home. But our home doesn't respond or react to this at all. It's as if we never left. And indeed, we gradually realize that we never did leave. But first of all, there's no reaction. There's no reaction to our enlightenment. There's no enlightenment to enlightenment. Okay, this is a way of, shorthand way of coding it. There's no enlightenment to enlightenment. And I'm feeling, you know, elated by this. This is just tremendous. I say, well, if I had known that, I would have slipped into the waters, you know, long ago. I mean, if I had known this, because our whole belief system has believed that, you know, we're going to get some great celebration. We're finally home, you know, massive parade and celebration and stuff. And there's no parade. There's no celebration. There's no reaction. There's no acknowledgement, no recognition, nothing. It's just we realize that, everything is still. This is so wonderful. I like it here. I love it here. So this is a gigantic paradigm shift. And it's absolutely necessary. We must, and we are, making this recognition and shift. There is no enlightenment to enlightenment. Now, externally in the world, if there's someone enlightened here, we might be celebrating and look at it as a parade, as it were. But what we get out of it as we come to it is we get this realization that there's no enlightenment to enlightenment. There's no reaction at all to us, our realizing that there's no reaction in God. So after this long, terrible journey, this detour into fear, we finally arrive home and we find there's no reception for us. There's not even a ripple of reaction. So this is a tremendous wow factor. There's no stir in the stillness. The stillness remains absolutely still. There's no stirring at all that we have quote-unquote returned home. And in truth, we never left. The stillness never stopped being still. We did not cause any ripple in reality. We did not make an impression upon it by dreaming. We just fell asleep and were dreaming. We never left. So, this is the importance, is the realization we never left. So why is there some big reception for us returning? We're not returning. We never left. We just sort of fell asleep, as it were, and started dreaming. So it's more important to realize that we never left. If there was some big celebration of our return, this would actually indicate something different. But are we glad to realize this? Yes, we are very happy. But there's no reactivity. There's no pressure on us. No party. Everything remains completely still and untroubled and unmoved and calm. So nothing at all happens when we return. It's not a return when we wake up. Nothing at all happens. So we're going to need to adjust to this. I feel it's my reaction has been positive, and I say, wow, just give me a little while to adjust to this, and then we'll be good to go with this. This is great. We really need to, someone needs to wake up before the false flags, various situations in September happen. There's most definitely a big setup underway and a huge campaign about ready to be implemented. I'm surprised it hasn't happened earlier, but it's all arranged for this time now. Just because it hasn't happened earlier doesn't mean it will not. But the realization that we don't have to endure any sort of celebration or party, welcome back, nothing happens. So there is no enlightenment in enlightenment. Shorthand for nothing happens, no reaction from God. So we're going to continue looking at this and speaking of it. So we get used to it. This is the first step, is it? Yes, we can. Yes, we will. Yes, we already have done it. So it's okay. This is the three phases to the wow, as it were. Is first we say, wow, I can do this. It's there to be done. In other words, that there is this step to be taken, where it's no step and there's no recognition of any step at all. It's just stillness. So yes, I can. Then yes, I will. Means you have the will to do it. You feel I have the will to do it. And then yes, I've already done it. Which is what that does, it preps our expectations. When we practice affirmation, yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I've already done it. So yes, I can gets our attention on it. Yes, I will builds our intent. Yes, I've already done it fashions our expectations of what to expect. Yes, I've already done it. So three steps to assertion, to the wow, to flipping the script is this: yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I've already done it. So, all praise to the Holy Spirit, the ultimate teacher. Which suggests to us these little shifts here. There is no enlightenment to enlightenment. We need not worry about that. So the quiet S here is the wow. When we're quiet, it's a wow. And we're sitting very still. This helps manage the wow. It's super helpful to sit very still. Don't move. And because this radically changes entire landscape. So if the whole landscape is suddenly shifted and changed, your reaction would just be very still. Say, well, I'm not going to make a single move at all, to do any action at all, nothing. Let me just sit here and survey the new landscape. And after surveying it for a while, then you start saying, okay, I get it now. We don't realize we're so used to our landscape, to our surroundings, to our expectations, to our imagery. We're so used to it that we take it for granted, that we don't realize that our functioning is based on our familiarity with it. If it were to suddenly shift and change, we would feel quite different. We'd feel uncertain. So when our inner landscape of expectation suddenly shifts in the most extraordinary way, we're not really certain, you know, how to respond to it, so we just sit quietly. And it's we don't have to have a response to it, except just a wow. See, short circuit all responses and just allow yourself to feel just this wow. You're not trying to spin it, not trying to intellectualize it, not trying to get on top of it conceptually or anything. This is so important to success, is you just be quiet. And by doing this, when you're skillful at this, this will enable your landscape to shift radically like this. Because you know, I can handle it. I know how to, you know, full stop in the wow. I can do it. So when we return home, nothing happens at all. There's no reaction whatsoever. No reaction. And this, you know, drastically changes our expectations. And yet we can just sit here, just comfortable, and let the wow be wow. We don't have to comment on it, judge it. This is the practice we do here. It's not something else. And we stick with it. We don't make excuses, apologize, justify. This is just what we do. This is what the Holy Spirit has indicated. This is what we do. Sit very still, very quiet. It's very important that you realize there's no pressure on the listener to say anything. Very important. Because if you're trying to formulate a position, this takes you out of the wow, out of the full stop. You don't have to formulate any position. Just manage the wow. The Holy Spirit is helping us with this path here. Ultimately, it's a Holy Spirit path, is what this is. And we have faith in the Holy Spirit here. The great teachers are very helpful, but ultimately this is a Holy Spirit path. So, there's someone who keeps the narrative going, which is what I'm doing. That's my role. But it's difficult. But for the rest, it's enough to hear, and what your aim is, the wow. That is their aim, to experience the wow. to experience this radical shift in your expectation. This is how you go very quickly on the path. And we need to go quickly. So the aim is to get to the wow. That means a radical shift has happened. And by you managing your success, managing the wow, this is the key to success. Because in doing this successfully, then you realize, hey, I can handle the next radical shift, whatever it may be. So this is how I'm able to get to this information, this perspective, is I have confidence. You see, we give ourselves permission to just sit here and do nothing. Say nothing. We need not formulate a position. When you're in the wow, you're not sure what your position is, and that's okay. You see? So, don't struggle to formulate a position, formulate a definition. It's okay to be uncertain for a little while, like, wow, I don't know exactly, you know, everything has shifted here, so let me just sit here quietly and let the dust settle. We're just letting the dust settle here. To not allow any narratives to get started. And in the wow, you may just feel like you don't know anything at all temporarily. You don't know what to think, what to say, what to judge. You just don't know. That's great. So I don't know. I don't know what I am. I don't know where I am. Because what I am and where I am and what I need to do, etc., is all based on a set of expectations we have projected into the future, based on what we believe we are. Or what we need to believe, what we need to do to become something, to become an identity, to attain identity, to receive an identity. See, we think there's that we don't, we can't have an identity until we get recognized that we have got an identity. But there's no enlightenment in enlightenment. There's no identity in identity. It's not like we get a pat on the back. God says, welcome back. Now you have an identity. Now there's nothing. Nothing happens. It's just we're aware of this infinite stability. And this stability does not change one bit based from our awareness of it, from our recognition of it. There's no reaction from the stability. Which is, of course, wonderful. If there was some reaction, it wouldn't be stability. You see? So we've been caught in this double bind, right? We think we need reaction to be what we are. Yet to be what we are, we need to recognize there's no reaction to what we are. So the way to, if there happens to be a teacher in this world, the way to respond is to come and sit quietly, be still. Because what you're doing is you're giving the benefit of doubt to the situation that there's going to be tremendous wows arising within you, tremendous shifts of perspective. And you must be really dedicated, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to sit here quietly. In order to manage my success of this radical shift in perspective, there's a temporary period where we just need to sit quietly, don't do anything. We feel safe this way. I'm not going to say anything because I don't know what needs to be said. So to take the pressure off of ourselves. There's no questions. People aren't giving me, you know, querying us, questioning us, asking this, doing. Now it's a given that if our intent is to shift our perspective and work on this, we will shift our perspective. This is going to be triggered somehow. We have faith in that. Our glass is half full. We have faith. Our perspective is going to be will be shifted. So we expect this. So we put ourselves in optimal, no pressure situation, so this can happen successfully, and we can manage the happening of it successfully. So those who have realized this, you know, the way they is to, you know, come here, sit down, be quiet. That's it. We're so caught up in our questions, trying to think, you know, that we miss, this blocks it. Don't have expectations. I need an answer on this question. I need an answer. Come with an open mind of no agenda as far as, you know, questions. Because it's the ego that gives us these questions to ask. trying to block a radical shift in perspective. Trying to say, well, I want to just keep it on this narrow. No, that's not what it's about. It's never about that. When if you come to see someone who's truly realized, it's never about that. I've never received answers to specific questions. Well, how do I deal with this problem or this situation? It doesn't seem to work that way. It's when you drop the demand for for a specific narrative into a question or something. What happens then is this title change happens of perspective, which is way better. Way, way better. I know that there's a lot of, one might think, well, we're being quiet because we're trying to be still or trying to reach some estate. No. It's more like we're committed to taking no action. Temporarily committed to no action at all. And then we're able to experience this perspective shift, and we still don't take any action. We don't react to it. The wow is the only reaction. We say, that's it. I'm not going to go any further than just this wow. Wow, there's been a huge shift. Imagine like there's a huge earthquake. You just continue sitting absolutely still. Wow, there's been a huge earthquake. Okay. Because this is just, it's astonishing. There's no reaction to my returning home. Of course, our whole purpose of dreaming we left is to get a reaction when we return. And to find out there's no reaction at all is quite stunning. Our whole purpose is to change God. So we're trying to get a response, a reaction, an impression, an impact. We want to think we made some impact, and there's none. The stability remains perfect. So our entire wandering, aimless wandering was all for nothing, right? Absolutely. All for nothing. Now, there's going to be a tremendous rocking of of the world, a pivoting towards a ferocious narrative controlled by cosmic corporate culture, controlled by the pharmaceutical company. The whole healthcare industry is driving it into belief in immortality, that mortal, that this mortal mind as a, is real, and that's our reality. This is a drastically terrible narrative that is going to be marketed ferociously, and that there's going to, by hook and by crook, try to pan everybody into this, to herd everybody into this pen. So, but we're punching first here. They want to keep us, so they want to make us spiritually inarticulate, meaning not having the tools, the real articulateness is this full stop in the wow, the doing this is spiritual articulateness. They want us reacting, reacting, acting, acting, reacting, reacting, acting, acting. Some people never give themselves permission to do nothing. I don't mean being lazy. This is not being lazy. This is being intensely engaged here. This is the most intense engagement there is, actually. It's the highest level of engagement, the highest level of management, is this full stop in the wow. So, recognize that when you're doing this, you are super responsible, super high management, highest management, the highest level of engagement, the highest level of intensity there is allowing this tremendous perspective shift. It's the ultimate in being responsible. So those of you who are doing this, keep in mind that you're being, uber responsible, the highest responsibility you're engaged in. So you don't have to hang your head in. Not at all. So giving yourself permission to do nothing like this is the highest level of engagement and intensity and responsibility and management. Because this enables the massive tidal change, massive perspective shift. And it allows the dawning of true stability, true mental stability. It allows us to ease into the abiding, ease into abidance. And this is very different than the stress reducing yoga and meditation that the world is, the ego's advising. Very different. This is not what we're doing at all. We're in shock by tremendous realization and recognition, and we're sitting quietly managing that shock. Very different. We're committed to taking no action. The mind wants to spring into action in many, many different directions. We're saying we're not doing anything. We don't allow the mind to spring into action in some way. We keep it quiet, even to the point of speaking, talking, questioning, all this stuff. We're not lazily daydreaming at all. Mind is quiet. We're keeping it quiet. This is an effort. We don't allow suggestions of action to arise. We don't argue, we don't engage in inner arguments. We're just committed to say, I'm not going to do anything right now, period. So there is to it. Arguments are always over what to do, you know, what position. We're not going to take any position, we're not going to do anything, so there's nothing to argue about. We're not trying to heighten our senses or heighten awareness, not trying to do anything. See, we're not trying to do anything externally, not trying to do anything internally either. Just letting the shock dissipate. There's no reaction to returning home, quote unquote returning. There's no reaction to waking up. This, the perfect stability remains perfect stability. No, not even a ripple. See, we're not resting. None of that. This is active. Our mind, our will, our attention is focused on making sure we remain in just a full stop mode. So this is like a workout. We're not formulating any position, neither positive nor negative. see, as soon as I introduce this idea, there's no enlightenment in enlightenment. There's no reaction to our awakening whatsoever. There's no recognition to our recognition. I knew the wow, the power of the wow. I could feel it. So I didn't wait. I immediately just got right into it. You see, you don't wait. You don't say, well, you know, maybe I'll do it tomorrow. And no, you do it right away and stay with it. See, we're not even taking the position of stillness as a position. We're just not doing anything at all, not reacting, not trying to develop a position of stillness. We're staying balanced, as it were, neither retreating nor advancing. Not trying to formulate a position, just knowing that, wow, I need to just sit here and let the dust settle. So if we were to ask, well, what's your position on what was just said? So I don't have any position right now. But I know just right where I am, I'm okay. Everything else just seems dusty, you know, and not really sure. So I'm not going to try and struggle to formulate a position, you know, when everything is uncertain like this. I'm not trying to find bliss, find something. No, I'm not searching at all. Just sitting, not searching. Just calming down, allowing the everything to calm down. Taking a lot of reactivity out of the whole situation, you see, taking it out, evaporating the reactivity to it all. And that means next time it's entertained, it will be, you know, much clearer and easier. And that itself will bring up a wow. You said, wow, I don't feel any, you know, hardly any resistance to it. This wow. And we'll have to dissipate that wow at that time. That's why success has to be managed. Success breeds success. And even the fact that we're managing this success properly, appropriately, that too brings up a wow. So full stop on the wow brings up another wow. You know, it reverberates. So you have to just let the overall complex settle in. There's an underlying realization like, wow, I'm being very, very successful here. So you just have to accept it and let it settle in. And what will we do with the success? Help others do the same as we're doing now. So there's nothing we need to do really so much except be quiet. Be still and just help others do what we're doing right now. Now as thoughts and start to return, and we're kind of falling back asleep, as it were. We made a push here to wake up, right? And then we're shocked by it, but we say, okay, it's okay, the shock's not too bad, I can get used to this. And then gradually we start falling back asleep. And you can feel it. The dullness, some sort of dullness kind of returns, and oh, okay, I'm back as a distracted mind. But the shock of this recognition is it reaches all the way into our distracted mindness. That distracted mindness is sort of on the periphery, and as we sort of get tired of the full stop and the wow, it starts to start creeping back in like clouds. Very interesting. I looked at my thumbnail today, where I had that very black mark, and let me see if we can. You see, right in the middle of it, there's a white spot now, like a clearing in this dark. See that white spot? I noticed that today. There's this white spot. It's quite extraordinary. In this darkness, this terrible darkness, which I've said this was a sign, there's terrible darkness coming in the world. And yet, right in the middle of it, there's this beautiful white spot which is completely clear of the darkness. And this is what we're aiming for. This is what we believe will happen. Ultimately, what is sustaining the madness of this world is our belief that there's going to be a reaction when we return home. Ultimately, everyone has this delusion. We have to get to this. Because if we really realize and accept it, that it's okay, there's no reaction at all, the stability is still perfect, we wouldn't waste any time continuing to project this world. And there wouldn't be anything to fix. You know, we're just continuously projecting these issues and problems, so we're distracted. We keep saying, well, God's not ready for me yet, you know. There's no response. Okay, God's not ready. I haven't done enough yet. I haven't been had enough, heroic enough. I haven't suffered enough, you know. We think, well, if we just suffer enough, we'll return home. God will react to that. Oh, I'm so happy you're not suffering anymore. Or, you know, or we haven't done enough. Oh, I'm so happy you saved the world from, you know, climate change or something. Or I'm so, you accomplished something. I'm so happy, you know, finally you accomplished something. Now I can bestow identity upon you or something. No, none of that will ever happen. You know, there'll never be any reaction from God. So there's no need to keep doing all this stuff. Trying to fix anything, trying to do anything, to prove ourselves, to attain some reaction. So to help the world is to spread this practice. That's the only way to really help anything. It's funny. It's not funny. It's sad that the people who are frantically trying to fix the world, they're the ones who are most active, running around producing the highest carbon footprint, you know. And whereas if people just spent their time sitting like this, carbon footprint would almost disappear on this planet. The planet would refresh itself, you know. But no, just the opposite. People are more active than ever. They're traveling more, doing more, consuming more, all this stuff. It's ridiculous. When you do this, you don't even need to eat very much. Actually, I don't need to eat very much at all. You're not out buying. You don't need much money because you don't need to buy much at all. I mean, everything will slow down. The whole civilization, the whole culture, everything would become much, you know, stiller and quieter. And, you know, but no, you didn't, never a word about that. The commissars need to, you know, be frantically busy managing everything, you know. Pharmaceutical companies don't want that. They want us to be sick. They want us to, accidents. I mean, I heard somebody say, talking about one of their relatives was getting in the hospital, getting more treatment. And someone said, yeah, well, the hospitals, they want to make money, which is true. The suppliers to the hospitals want to make money. You know, it's an economy. I think the overall entire healthcare system, all the insurance companies, all the hospitals, all the doctors, all the nurses, all the staffing, all the suppliers, all the medications, all the, you know, on and on and on, all the rehab, all the you know, care, you name it. It's the biggest industry in the world. Including all the preventative, all the vitamins, all everything, taking care of our health is the biggest industry in the world. It's just the greatest obsession we have. And we want to, you know, perpetuate that. We feel, well, we have to have all of that. Well, how are we going to perpetuate it unless we're vulnerable? Unless we get sick, unless we have troubles, unless we have surgeries, unless we go to the hospital. How are we going to perpetuate that? So we try to have our cake and eat it too. We try to be spiritualize mortal existence, but keep mortal existence. Which is really the attempt to produce an impression upon God. Destabilize God, actually. Remember, God shines as everything and remains as nothing. This is the stability of God. We're trying to change that and to prove that we're greater than God. That we can produce a change in God. So we're pretending to that you've gone to this pretense that we're not what we are. So we think we're mortal, mortal now. Mortal mind. And we say mortal mind meaning, well, there's got to be a cause for this mortality other than our pretending. If we say there's no mortal mind, well, then we'll be aware that we're pretending all of this, and then we can stop pretending. The healthcare industry doesn't want us to stop pretending that we're mortal. So they'll advise all sorts of things, but never, you know, the right spiritual practice that actually works. I mean, we can do infinite sort of practices that don't work. Give an illusion of spirituality or something. And we have been doing that. And I've said that oftentimes religions have functioned as a healthcare industry, especially Christianity, was sort of turned into a healthcare industry. And Catholicism in particular, but also all Christianity. It was seen as this is where you go for your healthcare. And ultimately they set up, a vast number of hospitals. I mean, the Catholic Church has set up so many, many, many hospitals, right? And heavily involved in healthcare. All the relics, all the relics, the bones of saints and martyrs and apostles, etc., artifacts of, seem to have some talisman type power, to heal, because it really, triggers people's faith to temporarily, all illness is just a fantasy in our mind anyway. So you can shift the fantasy a little bit and the symptoms, disappear. But we're still asleep, still fantasizing, we're mortal. It doesn't affect a change in that at all. Look at any magazine, any the information we're getting in the world is tailored by pharmaceutical companies and healthcare industry. They're supplying the money for the advertising in the magazines. Any magazine you look at, you can see that it's very heavily supported by healthcare industry, pharmaceuticals, you name it. The newspapers, the internet, everything is. Do you think you're ever going to get the right practice from that? There's no way. No way whatsoever you will. Not a chance in hell that you're going to ever get it in that way. Ramana Maharshi had the cancer of the arm. They said, we need to treat it. He says, what do you mean? Treat what? The body? I'm not the body. I'm this perfect stability. I'm quote unquote the self, but it's perfect, seamless stability. Totally untouchable. I'm not sick. I'm not suffering. This body's nothing but like a faint shadow, a shell, faint shadow shell. It's not me at all. It's nothing to do with me. So I don't care. I'm not. There's no reason to treat anything. So he said, no, I don't want any treatment. That's typical of the teachers, We don't realize how our education is controlled by the healthcare industry. Our information is controlled. The narrative of this world is controlled by the healthcare industry, which is ultimately our concern with our physical well-being and our feeling we need to cater to mortal mind. This is how we delay, we cater to it. I have all sorts of infirmities. Do I go to a doctor? No. Do I go to a doctor? Do I have anything checked out? No. I don't do anything about it. I'm not recommending this for everyone. These are not, if you have an infected tooth, you better have it pulled out. But, I could be getting MRIs and scans and, doctor's visits and injections and surgeries, and I could be spending a fortune on healthcare now. I'm not spending a penny on it, except I have to pay, this health insurance, which is basically consumes every bit of money I earn This goes all into health insurance. So just be pragmatic about it. You know, but this is just an example. I don't run to the doctor. This is all in my mind. Everything's in our mind, actually. So I said, what is it? What is it in my mind that is expressing itself as this symptom? And they're trying to outlaw, you know, mental healing. That's exactly what they're trying to do. Faith healing, mental healing. They want to make it, you know, criminal offense if someone goes to a faith healer or something and they don't happen to get well, then you know the faith healer's liable for murder or whatever, you know. This is where we're at now. This is how severe, you know, the situation is in the world. I cannot emphasize enough how drastically terrible the narrative of this world is right now. Just continuing with this wow, we're sort of flipping the script a little bit. We're just a little cool down flipping the script, but the wow is still reverberating very strongly. I mean, this is a, you know, permanent shock. I mean, this shock leaves a permanent impression upon us. We've allowed this idea into our mind, and it's creating a lot of commotion. And yet the way this stabilizes is we take no position on it one way or the other. Yes and no. I'm both taking a position and not taking a position. If you want to be active about it and you're conceptually active, this is how you can keep stay full stop on the wow. As you say, yes, I'm both taking a position and not taking a position. See, this enables us to be conceptually engaged and still full stop in the wow. Yes, I both believe this and do not believe this. So essentially, no position right at this point. See? I both accept this and do not accept this. This is both helpful and not helpful. It's very odd that this display is now larger on the screen. I don't know what I did. Maybe I guess you can resize it. I must have sized it somehow. Interesting. It's larger now. Oh yeah, I can size it. Oh, look at that. Awesome. See, getting bigger picture. Bigger picture here. Wow. I always thought I was stuck with the size that it first pops up. This is the size, and now I see I'm not stuck with that. Wow. See, the realization that there's no reaction at all, that means we don't have to do anything. In order to wake up, there's nothing we need to do. Which means we can do it right now. Right? You see the logical extension of this. Is there's nothing we need to do. Because there's not going to be a reaction no matter what. No reaction whatsoever. So there's nothing we need to do at all first. It's going to be the same whether we do anything or not. Which means since we don't have to do anything, nothing is required, certainly. If there's no reaction no matter what, how could there be a requirement then? So since there's no requirement, that means we don't need to do anything. That means we can Wake up right now. Time isn't, there's no need for the notion of time. There's no demand from reality that there be such a thing as time, space, process, and form. We put that demand on ourselves, thinking we needed to accomplish something, get a reaction out of God. So where do we think we are as we're working on getting a reaction? Well, we think we're in time, space, process, and form, because we believe that you know, this is what's required to get a reaction. Otherwise, we'd realize that there isn't any reaction. If in the now, we'd realize there is no reaction. There's nothing we need to do. So we're just imagining that there's such a, that there's time, space, process, and form. It's all a wishful thinking on our part. There really isn't any such thing. But it's what we believe is necessary for us to be trying to generate a reaction without being aware that there is no reaction. We're saying, well, you know, it takes time to get the reaction. But since there is no reaction, you know, time is just an imaginary wish that we have, actually. Shining is everything, remaining is nothing. So we realize in this position, seeing this, that no matter what appearances seem to be taking place, you know, the beingness is not being disturbed at all. The beingness of everyone is not being disturbed in the slightest bit. So death, misery, suffering, torture, all this stuff is nothing. It's absolutely nothing. It doesn't even exist. It's wishful thinking, nothing more than that. Wishful thinking on the part of consciousness, which includes everything, you know, all these appearances. Is a play of consciousness, you might say, right? It's our the play of consciousness is just our wishful thinking, actually. And this is not just with people or humans, with everything, with rocks, everything that appears, animals, insects, vegetation, rocks, water, fire, air, you know, mass, everything. The universe is wishful thinking. There's no reaction. There's no reaction to recognition. There's no enlightenment to enlightenment. No reaction to recognition. So we're back in hardcore practicing now. This is great. I sort of have was distracted away from this a little bit, which is understandable, because I really had to recognize what's going on. I needed to see what, you know, the chess pieces, and now that I'm seeing it, yesterday I saw it, and it's, oh, I see now. Okay. So we're back with this really great, pristine practicing. Keep in mind, as we entertain these ideas, it fundamentally shifts our perspective. We can never go back to the way we used to view it. Now, habits will creep in, but they don't have the grip on us that they used to have. This is important to realize. The clouds come back in, but it's easier for us to dissipate the clouds. They don't have the grip on us. So don't be dismayed if the clouds come back in. They'll come back in. Habits will come back in. But it's a lot easier to just say, oh, okay, push them aside again. And apparently, when we recognize the stability, the habits of the personality, we don't even need to change them. It doesn't matter. See, nothing needs to be accomplished. There's no attainment necessary. Nothing to acquire. You know, we already are that. Always have been. So just let the personality, let the body and the personality just be what it is. I don't even need to worry about, you know, do I need to change, you know, my habits or this. Well, I mean, just the basic way that you are. Doesn't matter one way or the other, really. As Ram Maharshi said, it's the peace that suffuses the surroundings, the atmosphere, that you can tell. You can identify a saint by that. Not by their habits of their body or their personality. When you turn off a fan, you know, let the fan keeps going for a while, and it just slows down like that. But you don't have to be troubled by, you know, habits and personality. They're all diffuse and pushed off to the side, as it were. And in this space is this stability, this peace. It's the peace that you know the saint by. Not their body expression or action, but really the suffusion of the whole area. It's like this thumbnail. You see, peace arrives, and there's this area in the middle of all this darkness that is light, you know, that is very light, that is peaceful and light. It's not all agitated and sharp and turbulent. Peaceful and light. This is what we want. Tell ourselves, this is what we really want, and therefore this is what we will receive. Recognition of perfect stability. All the action of appearing makes no dent on it whatsoever. It's never stirred into any turbulence. It's never reacting to the dancing, the dance of appearancing. So we might call this activated stillness. We're in a very activated state, and remember, yet we're remaining still. We're in a a state of elation and trepidation. Wow, there's the tremendous elation brings about some trepidation, saying, wait a minute, not so fast. So whatever I do or don't do makes no difference to the stillness. Whatever is done or not done doesn't make any difference. So we might as well be aware of the stillness and the stability. We might as well be aware of it. Nothing that we do is going to make a change it in the slightest bit. So we just let the logic play out here. There's an inherent logic to this. We don't need to force it. There's an obviousness to it, so we don't need to struggle, try to define that. Just let it work out. So we're giving ourselves the opportunity, letting reason function here. And it sees, I see it. Let me just let this calm down though. First a while, let the file calm down first. So this issue is so important. We're giving it plenty of time here. This is an extraordinary breakthrough, you know. It's super, super valuable recognition. It's a knockout blow on the world agenda here. It's a knockout blow on the narrative that the ego is trying to push on us. So people have to feel, we have to feel here, we have access, some stream of grace in this world. We have to feel there's some way, you know, of accessing this, of getting reassurance from this. We have to have this. Otherwise, the narrative that the ego is pushing upon us, we will find reasons to pay attention to it. We'll make excuses to pay attention to it. The ego will give us all sorts of excuses. Well, you know, this and this and this and this and... So I'll give this some time here. And sometimes after this, it's good to rest. You see, we've been getting nervous leading up to September. August was a very stressful month, and I eat too much. I mean, it was just almost unbearable, because we know we're getting close to this massive marketing campaign, which could include false flags, all sorts of stuff. The ego is going to throw everything at us. And the Holy Spirit pointed this out to us. I said, from June 22nd, 2015 to June 22nd, 2016, this is when all hell will break loose. All the pressure will be upon us. The world will be fundamentally changed by the time we get to June 22nd, 2016, because of this massive marketing campaign, the massive pressure, this narrative, which is going to be, you know, marketed so intensely through all sorts of means, all sorts of angles and pressures will be brought to bear. So the stress of August was our realization that this campaign is going to be launched in September. And so I was feeling like, wow, are we going to make it? Are we going to be ready? Are we going to survive this? Is it possible? And so it's very stressful. But now we're really close to, as I say, the conception of this marketing campaign, as it were. Maybe September 11th, maybe some false flags. There's something around this. The pressure will be on us. So we're now like 5 days away. So at this point, it's more like, his ability to focus now better. Ability to focus better. It's do or die time, so to speak. And so there's this less anxiety, because it's go time for us, and we're getting it now. We're getting the answers we need. This white spot in the middle of this dark spot has just been a recent, very recent situation that just recently occurred. Just recently occurred. So this means that what we need is here now. It's coming. It's coming. I feel we're going to be okay. But yeah, I've been feeling just this enormous intensity and push, realizing the pressures that will be brought to bear upon us will be ungodly. Ungodly pressures. But this is known by the Holy Spirit. There was a feeling like during August, like that maybe there's some way to deal with this pressure, you know, by eating and just enjoying life and stuff, and hoping, like, you know, because it wasn't quite there yet. I hadn't quite, you know, seen what I'm seeing now. So I think maybe I need something else, like just to, you know, eat ice cream all the time, and this will help us through. And then I realized, no, that's not enough, and graphics are not enough. Maybe I can just look at some beautiful graphics, and that will do it. And no, that's not enough. So I had to drop, you know, dropping this stuff and getting back to this practice here is what's important. Already dropped some weight. About, you know, almost 7 pounds already dropped off. Already stopped looking at the news, paying attention to what's going on, all that's, you know, dropped off, which, and I'm, so now I'm able to get back to this practicing here, this intense wow, you know, this is great that we're able to get to this. This is just tremendous, you know, breakthrough, that, you know, enlightenment has no enlightenment, realization has no realization to it. Meaning there's no reaction, there's no additional step to take. You know, there isn't any reaction from God. There's no reaction. It's like we step into this peace, and there's just the peace. There's not peace saying, hey, wait a minute, you just stepped into peace. This is actually absolutely astonishing. This is creating turmoil in me. I'm so elated. God doesn't have a problem with elation. You know, the peace remains absolutely peaceful. And this is what, you know, trips us up. It was, we have glimpses of reality, but it's so difficult. It's been so difficult for us to abide in it. And this is what we need to offset this marketing campaign. Is abidance. We need those who are abiding in it, not those who have glimpsed it and are speaking about their grand clarity about it, or beautiful graphics and all that stuff is fine, but it's not with the times. It's not flowing with the times at all. We absolutely have to have abidance in it. Absolutely have to have abidance in it. Nothing else is going to work. This is how intense the marketing campaign will be. So everyone has to feel, you know what? There is abidance here in the world. There is abidance. It's not enough to give a, you know, a graphic of Ramana Maharshi right now and say, well, there was abidance. You know, we need abidance right here, right now. So that the ego cannot, all its spin doesn't work. Say, ego say, well, it's a new age, you know. There's no abidance in the new age. Right? That was just some archaic reaction of resistance to the new age here. And now that we have the new age, we realize how great it is, you know, our accomplishments and achievements are really making, that this is really going to cause a reaction in God. The reason why, they'll say, the reason why Ramana was able to abide was because it hadn't really, we were still in the Stone Age. We hadn't really reached this modern age, you know, and so they didn't have any accomplishments, but that's why God was peaceful. But now that we have all this, you know, accomplishments of, my gosh, you know, we're so advanced now, surely this is producing the reaction that we're looking for in God. There's no question about it, the ego will say. So you see how the ego has managed to get some sort of leverage over us here by all the technology. But we can just say, no, it's still the Stone Age. This belief is a Stone Age belief that we can get reaction from God. This it always remains a Stone Age belief, no matter how gilded we try to make it. It's like we have a Stone Age chariot, like Fred Flintstone, and going along on stone wheels. And somebody comes along and says, "Hey, wait a minute, you know, let's paint the wheels gold." So we paint the wheels gold, and everybody's saying, "Oh my gosh, you know, surely God is going to have a reaction to this. This is amazing." So now we're rolling along stone wheels that are painted gold. And we think, you know, the idiots before, they had stone wheels, in unpainted stone wheels, and of course they were, God has no reaction, so they could abide in the peace of God. But now that we painted the stone wheels gold, my gosh, God is just like jumping turbulent. I mean, stability is now all turbulent, is, you know. And that's what we wish. And so our thoughts are all turbulent because that's what we wish. We're saying, well, This is, you know, this is a reflection of the turbulence of God. But no, we're just making it all up. That's what we want. We want to believe. So we want the evidence that indicates to us that turbulence is possible. Turbulence is possible. Yeah, this is what I believe that God is going to be like because of our, you know, God has to recognize our greatness. Look what we've done. Look how we've changed reality. Wow. So the willingness to experience the shock was vitally important. Now, I've been willing to do this. And getting used to it. See, this gives me 5 days to get used to this. Gives you 5 days to get used to this also. And of course, it's just a complete game changer. Obviously, it is. As much as possible, absorb the shock of this. It's super helpful. We may not experience the helpfulness of it immediately, but that's because the logic is seeing it by saying, well, it's got to calm down, but I see the logic of it. But still, the shock is there, so I'm not going to, you know, make any move, which is what our discipline. Don't try to force a move. Very important. Do not be forceful with this. Forcefulness in this path ends up having diminishing returns. You have to be neither be seductive nor forceful. Okay. So we're covering both angles there, right? So we don't get hooked into thinking that, oh, I can be sneaky. Don't be sneaky, deceitful, seductive, nor forceful. It's neither one of those. It's neither the yin nor the yang. Okay, it's very important. You're not practicing as a yin or a yang, a male or a female at all. You're practicing as the voice of reason, as the voice, as spirit, as wisdom, as the guidance of the Holy Spirit speaking to to the wisdom of spirit, of eternal mind, your eternal mind, your eternal mind practicing here. So we're not trying to force our way, either obviously or covertly. There's many who have all sorts of covert ways to force their way, and they think, well, that's okay, because it's the overt ways that the obvious forcing. They say that's what's wrong. I'm not obvious about it, so that makes it okay. No, it doesn't make it okay. It still gets in the way. It gets in the way even more than, you know, than obvious forcing. Because at least obvious forcing, you can at least, you know, stop. Say, stop. Hey, it's obvious. Let's stop it. Whereas the covert way, you know, there's much more wrangling about it. So, well, I'm not being obvious about it. So, I mean, that shouldn't be a problem. No, it still gets in the way. And since we do it more, it gets in the way even more. But as we accept the shock of this, you know, we don't need to force our way, right? We realize, hey, wait a minute. There's an inherent logic to this. There's an inherent reason to it. And this is going to take care of it, ultimately. When we calm down, reason will just say, hey, this is the obvious step to take, and we'll take it. We don't have to force our way. We must avoid trying to either overtly or covertly force our way here. So with full stop on the wow, you must be very careful not to go in any of this covert struggle, okay? You're not struggling anyway. Not subtle planning, not crafty, clever, not seductive planning, none of this. Not emotional planning, none of this. We're not making any plans, we're not trying to do anything. So it's both external action and inner action, overt and covert, which we're saying no to. We're not doing anything. We're not going to make any plans. We're not deciding about anything right now. We're just enjoying the shock, really. Give ourselves permission to enjoy the shock. This is wonderful. Because within this shock is a tremendous amount of elation. It's like surfing a wave. It's very much like surfing a wave. But we're just cruising on the wave. Instead of trying to do a bunch of radical maneuvers, like carving up the wave, you know, radical bottom turns, off the lip, cutbacks, you know, slamming the lip and dropping back in and trying to get in the tube and, you know, all these radical maneuvers that were, you know. No, just cruise. Just cruise on the wave. Don't show off. Just enjoy the steady, smooth cruising on the wave. So the reason is there. I've seen it. The reason says, aha. Now I see. Okay. But don't try to act on that reason immediately, or you'll start struggling. Problems you'll get in your own way. You get in your own way. You'll wipe out. You start doing a bunch of radical cutbacks, you probably catch an edge and wipe out. So just keep steady, keep balance, keep poise, and just surf the shock. Surfing the wow. Now, we don't try to make anything more of than it is. That's like if you catch a wave and maybe it's not so big or whatever. You try to get a whole bunch out of the wave, we call it. Try to milk the wave, get a bunch of action on it. Just take whatever the wave is, just take it as it is. And just surf it steady into shore. Don't try to make anything more. It's like you're longboarding. You're just cruising. You see these kids, and they get a little wave, and they're just thrashing around desperately trying to get something out of it. It just, just cruise on the wave. Don't try to make anything more of it, more or less of it. The shock is plenty here. It's severe. We don't need to make anything more of it. It's really like surfing a big wave. The problem is, if you're used to carving up waves and then you drop in on a huge wave, your habits might take over and you might try to do too much and you wipe out. So this is why we practice surfing little waves. So when we drop in on an enormous wave like this one, a huge, huge perspective shift, fundamental perspective shift, we just stay steady and just ride it into shore. I mean, ride into shore and walk into shore and say, "Yeah, that was fun." People say, "Did you realize how big that wave is?" Well, yeah. That's okay. I just stayed steady and do what I always do. Just rode it into shore. No problem. I used to have posters of, big waves in my room as I was young. I remember Greg Knoll at the pipeline. It's just this incredible picture. It was zoomed, but it was just like the wave looked like it was like 100 feet high. It was just unbelievable. And so I always, dreamed of riding big waves, really big waves. Well, this is the biggest wave of all. We're riding the biggest waves of all. Right here. It's way more intense, actually, than riding with a Chapu or Tahiti and a pipeline, sunset, Mavericks, wherever. This is way, way more intense. We cannot afford to wipe out here. And there's a community of big wave surfers. They understand what it's about. They let you be. They just let you be. They understand. This morning when the Holy Spirit gave me this idea, it was like dropping in on a, massive wave. And I said, okay, here we go. being like towed in on some, 100-foot wave or something. Towed in on it, and now you're going real fast, and you realize, okay, here we go. So it's really like surfing. There's an awesome waves here, these videos like this, and you get the experience of being in on it. And even when you get near to shore, the wave is still big. There's still some sections that are, really intense sections to the wave. And even when you're in, wave's finished, you're walking in, you still feel the intensity of the wave. You get on the beach, you still feel the intensity of the wave. And what you want to do is acknowledge that you rode it the proper way. So you don't start thinking about, well, I should have cut here, I should have done more. No. You don't allow yourself to think that at all. Respect the power of the wave. The ego will always say, well, you should have done more, should have done more. What the ego is really looking for is a wipeout. Tell you the truth here. So if you don't wipe out, the ego says, well, you should have done more. Yeah, well, but it'll say it in a friendly way. You start out, well, you could have cut back here, you could have done this, you could have looked at maybe differently, and so it enters all these thoughts into your head. Whereas the only important issue is to ride this wave successfully into the shore. That's the only important issue, is to avoid wiping out. You're not doing it for show at all. So the ego, the only important issue is to wipe out. And so you get back into confusion and turmoil. You see, that's its goal, but it will try to be clever about it and engage you in spiritual talk. Say, well, maybe you did, you should have maybe, you didn't quite do enough there. It's not quite the way, and try to engage you in that way. But avoid that. At this point, when we're riding the big waves, there's no kibitzing here. There's no kibitzing allowed. We're respecting the power of this wave, the power of this insight is extraordinary. So there has to be silence. So you can't have this, you get into the beach and there's people that say, oh yeah, man, that was cool, yeah, but you could have done a lot more on that wave, what's the problem? You can't have that going on. Because the people on the beach watching, they realize that they need to ride that wave too at some point. And if you start saying, well, you should have just, cut it up, more, they'll freak them out. They're not going to do it. They want to see, how does it feel afterwards? They want to know that. How does it feel? How much wow is there, But if they see somebody handling the wow of it and succeeding, they're going to say, hey, I can succeed too. It's like you get in the tube of how do you say it, Jopau, of Tahiti. The tube is so insane. It's all you can do just to stay steady. You're not cutting up when you're in that tube at all. The slightest miscalculation and you're just doomed, So just getting through it, remaining stable, remaining poised, keeping on the right line, not your mind not panicking and saying, do I need to do more, like that. is just pure minimalism. You reach a point where pure minimalism is what you're after. And what happens is the more you're willing to have this pure minimalistic approach, the bigger the wave becomes, the more intense it becomes, the more intense the insights become, the more challenging they become, and the more you need to take even a more of a minimalist approach. Because these waves have to be ridden before the marketing campaign gets underway here. The intense, extreme, full-on, final push marketing campaign of the ego, cosmic corporate culture, the ego, to incorporate this planet into the way that they want it to be, under the belief that mortal mind is true and the only true mind there is. This is it. Mortal mind, we're stuck with it. Now let's make the most of it. You know, this kind of nonsense. So we have to realize these waves can be ridden. Now from a standpoint of watching on the beach, it's an intense experience too. Let's not minimize that at all. Very intense. It's not as intense as riding the wave, but you know, for instance, viewing this video is a very intense experience. Because you can identify in your mind, you're recognizing, you know, what's going on here. So all this guidance of the Holy Spirit, take a minimalist approach, take a minimalist approach. During my life, simplify, 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 simplify. This is all aimed for this right now, to be able to ride the really big waves, the biggest waves, because a minimalist approach is essential for this. Because ultimately, the waves cease entirely. And there's nothing but this absolute peace. So we need this, you know, complete minimalism. The realization that we don't need to do anything gives rise to this massive wave, this wow. But in riding this wave successfully, then you realize, I don't need to ride any more waves. And yet this wave has to be ridden, and yes, a minimalist approach is absolutely essential. So I got used to minimalism on the path. You have to get used to that more and more and more. No bells or whistles. You know, keep minimalizing, keep simplifying, keep minimalizing, keep simplifying. I mean, the wow, the realization I don't need to do anything, it makes no difference at all. You know, so I don't, there's nothing that needs to be done. I don't need any time, space, process, form. That's going to give rise to a huge wow. Huge wave. Then you just have to ride it. It's funny, I never got into big wave writing. Someone's telling me, you know, that's just an external symbol, but really get into the real big waves. The real big waves are the inner waves, the inner wow. Those are the true monster waves. And I said, yeah, I want to ride those. So I always wanted to be a big wave rider, actually. But it turns out the big waves are really inside. So if you want to ride the big waves, this is where you have to go. You have to get to this, these recognitions. There's no response to our enlightenment from God. Nothing happens. But in that nothing happening, this enables us then to accept our enlightenment. And by accepting our enlightenment, that means we are abiding in it now. So when you ride your waves, the wow waves, the waves of wowness, minimalist approach. You don't need to do anything. Just stay very minimalist. You don't need to explain, put it into this or that context. Just intent upon writing it and staying poised in the wow. In serving terms, you stay in the pocket. Stay in the pocket. There's a line where you're staying in the pocket and you're okay there. If you try to get out of that pocket, it's going to suck you up. If the wave's intense enough, it's going to just suck you up and flip you over. There's a lot of air. There's a lot of pressure. There's a lot of motion. And you're staying in the pocket. Staying in the pocket there, maybe stay in, and you'll be fine. Stay in the pocket of the wow. So we have a very minimalist approach here. This is essential. Now, when you come into the beach from riding a really huge wave, you're going to want to sit there and calm down, maybe for hours, actually. So give yourself permission to do that. Don't think you have to swing into action. Talk about it. No, you just sit there and let the experience, you know, just all settle in. Don't think you have to leverage it in some way. Supposed to warm up today. Heat wave is coming here, which I welcome, absolutely welcome. Wow. September is often the most awesome month of weather here. California, October also can be totally awesome. In fact, all months recently have been totally awesome. It's like getting ready for paradise, I guess. I mean, these last several years, it's going on 4 years, but I mean, this last year, what month wasn't awesome? All have been like just, every day is just incredible. You have to pinch yourself. Is this a dream, really? I mean, is this really happening? See, there's a silver lining. If you have spiritual purpose in life, whatever happens, you use it and make, you know, lemonade out of it. Get lemons, you make lemonade, really great lemonade. I know that this drought, you know, is intense, it's terrible, but you know, it's happening. So for me, I just say, wow, let's surf this wave and get this feeling of like every day is perfect. So I'm very used to now just feeling like every day is perfect. The atmosphere, the weather, and just enjoying it. It reflects this quiet, beautiful tranquility. Just, you know, it's just you feel, it's just so perfect. Just get used to it and enjoy it. It may be a gift the world is giving to us, and ultimately means we're giving to ourselves. This world is just a projection of our own desire. You see, it's just we're projecting this. So this may be just a projection of a gift that the world is, you know, giving me and those who look at it this way, preparing for someplace much, much better, where, you know, the projections are very smoothed out, projecting eternal life until we finally ultimately realize, except we don't even have to project at all. Don't have to pretend at all, no projection whatsoever, but in the meantime, we'll project this perfection in our environment. I mean, it's just the light, how everything looks, how everything feels, the atmosphere, it's just, you know, picture perfect. You talk about like postcard days, you see postcards, you know, in the winter time, and you're looking at these beautiful postcards of somewhere in the tropics or somewhere. Well, we have that every day here. Every day is a picture postcard day right now. And I'm not exaggerating at all. You know, I believe in weather tourism. I'm into weather tourism. I don't care about the buildings or architecture or anything. I'm into weather tourism. You know, where's the best weather in the world? And just sit there. And just experience it. For me, that's the best, highest experience, is the light and the weather. What's the quality of light and what's the weather like? I don't care about anything else, really. Very little else. It's not that important. What's the ambience? What is the ambience? I don't care about the activity, human activity, building, commerce, all every stuff's going on. I could care less. Going to museums, no. But let me just sit somewhere where You just feel this ambience, you know, oh, this is the light, everything. It feels stable, it feels perfect, you know, it's just wow. Because this helps trigger, you know, our desire for this to be continuous, for stability, for ultimate stability, the ultimate stability of God. It helps in that way. I always say the wealth is the weather. The weather is the wealth here. And the ambience is the wealth. The quality of light. That is the wealth here. Do we need these huge houses and mansions and all that stuff? Why? People are so into that, you know, you can just sit here. Imagine if there's nothing we could do to change this. You know, there's no matter what we do or what our action or thinking is, the ambience remains the same. And then when we like say, hey, do I really need to be going through all these reactions to my belief that I'm changing it if I can't change it? Do I really need good thoughts to fix the bad thoughts? Does that really make a difference what my thoughts are? If it doesn't make any difference at all, what my thoughts are, whether they're good or bad or whatever, why not just let the thoughts go? Why keep struggling with reactions? Reactions don't make any difference. Good, bad, whatever. Why do I need to fix my thoughts if the stability is going to be perfect no matter what my thoughts are? Keep in mind, this is a little tricky, keep in mind, all our good thoughts are, what we're doing is we're trying to camouflage our attempt to change reality by having good thoughts. And in order to have good thoughts, we need to have bad thoughts. So the good thoughts can say, well, I'm here to fix the bad thoughts, instead of I'm here obviously pretending, you know, to try and change reality. So we're taught to have bad thoughts to support the good thoughts, actually. We're literally put ourselves through training to have all these sort of bad, painful, negative thoughts, and so that they would give us an excuse, say, well, I have to have all these good, positive thoughts to try and fix the bad thoughts. But none of the thoughts affect the stability of God in the slightest bit. So we don't need any of them. See, the negative has always been used to justify the positive. But we don't need the positive either. The positive is just a very tricky way that we're using. Saying, well, I got to get a positive reaction. That's still a reaction. Our goal is to get a reaction, so we try to be sneaky and say, well, I'm just looking for a positive reaction from God. But the goal is to get an impression, a reaction, a change in God remaining as no thingness, a perfect no thingness, you see. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing. We're trying to be tricky about it. Again, I'm just trying to get a positive reaction. Nothing wrong with that, you know. And so we're working on our positive reaction by having these negative stuff. We claim, well, I've got to fix that. You know, I'm working on getting a positive reaction out of those negative thoughts. And this is practice to get a reaction out of God. We don't need to do this practice. It's useless. It's futile. So I would say, right now, given the situation that's going to, that I can see, the Holy Spirit's pointed out, okay, here it comes, and I'm able to recognize at least the plausibility of this, what the Holy Spirit's saying, I say, wow, that's very plausible, you know, where are we at here in this? Oh, pretty great. You know, 3 hours of effort, workout every day is, would be, you know, recommended. We're trying to get 2.5 here, which is good. 2.5, minimum of 2.5, I believe, given the extremity of what is to come. Now, this is not a joke. You know, it is an alarm. I'm sounding the alarm. I've been sounding it for a long time. You must understand that there's an enormous desire on a part of those who are communicating the narrative, those who are in charge of the narrative, of the ego narrative. There's an enormous desire to make a huge final push, a blitzkrieg push, and to resolve this issue once and for all of what our direction of the world future is going to be here, and to there, and then align everything with that decision. And the meeting of the Pope and the President on the 23rd in the morning, like 9:15 on the morning of the 23rd of September, is this huge symbolic moment that they've been waiting for. Okay, and they want all attention on that. There may be some attention getters that they use to put our attention on that. And then, you know, they're going to then say, hey, we have an accord, we have an alignment, we have an agreement between the two most central parties in the world. We're going to then push this to the ultimate. Just like when, for instance, on a small scale, when the Pope says something that gives the progressives some hope, you know, like, oh, the Pope actually feels, you know, that, you know, this is okay. And they leap on it like famished wolves. And just run with it, like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, this is great. The Pope is finally dropping Catholicism. He doesn't really believe in it. You know, this is all, he's finally admitting it's all been a mistake. You know, great, great, great. You know, go for it. And I say, all been a mistake. That's what they hope. You know, get rid of it. Of course, I'd say, of course, there have been various mistakes and errors, but those are to be corrected. You don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. The principle of becoming adept at the tools that we need to manage our success is all important. But no, they want to replace it entirely with this new world religion. And so they leap on anything he says and drum it up. The drums start pounding, pounding, pounding. My gosh, you know, the Pope is now for this. He's saying, well, this is okay. We're going to have women priests, you know, whatever it is. Oh my gosh, this is the greatest thing ever, you know. Finally, we finally, you know, are here. Now let's go for it. That's what they do. Well, with this meeting of the Pope and the President, this is like a million times more. I mean, they're going to say, finally, there are no more obstacles. Now, there can't possibly be any more disagreement. We're all on the same page. This is the truth. There's about the secular and religious agreement. This is our marching orders. We have our marching orders now. It's time to march. And the drums and the fifes and all the will start pounding, and you're expected to march. The marching music will begin, and you will be expected to march. Okay? The authorities will say, time to march in this direction. And if you don't march, you say, oh, you're not a marcher, huh? Well, we have ways to deal with that. Mach schnell. And yet we will have our direction saying, no, our direction trumps your direction for sure, without any question about it. And we will not tolerate any obstruction of what we're doing. We will not be marching to their tune at all. So the musicians, those who play the music of the march are all set. You just can imagine just a vast orchestra. There's the conductor. They're waiting for the conductor, you know, to drop the baton. Conductor's got the baton up there. Taps the podium, you know. Okay. And they're all on point. They're all on point. You know, the violinist is ready. Everybody's, you know, they're all ready. All on point. There's that moment, you know, right, where the conductor's letting them all focus in on the task at hand.